Hi, everybody. I'm Mary Angela Saavedra, the director of the Center on the Hill, and it is time for another episode of Tell Me Something Good. Now with special guests. I am joined today by Dan Spratlan, who is the director of music at the Presbyterian Church of Chestnut Hill. Thanks for joining us, Dan.
Hey, it's great to be here. Thanks for having me, Mary Angela.
Where are you joining us from?
I am joining you from my dining room here in Medford, New Jersey, where I live with the fam. We're kind of far away from a lot of chaos. And as you've seen when we've had our meetings, I'm able to sit outside a lot and enjoy some fresh air, which is a big part of what's going on now. But yeah, just at home, we got the dogs at the feet, so we're just waiting for somebody to knock and hear a bark.
Awesome. Well, thanks so much for being here. For those of you joining us for the first time, a little bit about what we're going to do here. I'm going to use this game called Storywise, which is 144 thoughtful ways to bond with a fellow human. It was given to me by Atria Senior Living. I picked three cards. We'll ask the questions at the end. I will ask you to email me your thoughts so you can join the conversation and let us know what you think. So without further ado, let's get started. Here's our first picture. Can you see that picture? It's a boy, he's dreaming, and above him is floating like an astronaut.
An astronaut with little stars above
him. Yeah, exactly, a little skull. And this question says, whether you think dreams are premonitions or just random. And I kind of have two thoughts on the matter, because I feel like sometimes I dream about things that I need to think about, like things I've kind of squashed down. And so then sometimes they come out in my dreams, and I'm like, that's weird. Oh, but also I've kind of not been dealing with that. So maybe that's why that came up. But when it came to this job that I have now as director of the Center on the Hill, the night before I saw the job posted, I dreamt about my grandmother. And I dreamt about the summer that I lived with her. I lived with her two summers, the summer of 98 and summer of 99 after college. And I dreamt about those summers because those summers were like the best summers of my life. I basically was kind of like a cruise director for her. I made sure she stayed active. We went bowling. I made sure she got to bridge club. I made breakfast for her. I took care of her. And I got to know a lot of her friends at that same time, you know, through a lot of, you know, hosted a lot of parties with for her and her friends. And I had so much fun. It was a really rewarding summer. And I dreamt about that summer the night before I saw this job posted. So when I saw the job posted, I was like, this is what that was. This job is what I was doing that summer. And it was so crazy that I dreamt about it the night before. And so then I was like, I have to apply for this job. Like, this is clearly my grandma, like somehow whispering in my ear, like, you should probably think about applying for this job. And so I did. So yeah, so for me, I think it's a little of both. Sometimes it's just random stuff kicked up from your subconscious, but then sometimes there's things like that happen, and I don't know. That was really interesting. Yeah. What do you think?
It's fascinating. Well, I mean, that's one of those things that's been eternal questions since the beginning of time, right? There's so many books written about dream interpretation and where does that fall into psychology, you know, the Freudian sense of, you know, you've got your ego working its way out in there and stuff like that, you know. And I'm somebody who remembers my dreams often. I dream lucidly quite a bit. And though my wife is one who feels that hers have more the sense of premonition, premonitory, whatever you call it, that she does get sort of senses from that. And she's one that does kind of not try and read signs that way, but she'll kind of have a sense, you know, like something big is coming at work, or there's a big change coming this way or another, or somebody's gonna have a health thing. While I have almost always been able to nail my dreams down to an exact, I mean, well, here, I'm a performer, right? Let's get that out of the way. I'm a singer and a conductor. So we all have anxiety dreams. And a lot of us that's just part of our existence. My parents had them as performers. Almost all of the friends that I have and colleagues that I have that in some way. You know, composers, they don't have the score ready on time. You know, you don't have your right outfit. You're at the wrong performance hall. You're at the wrong campus or city altogether. You have the wrong music. You know, everybody's on stage and you're in the bathroom. Like, all these things come through. And I found it so much that, oh, there it is. I knew it would that while so much of that is kind of, I think, reflection, like you say, working your own things out. Like, in general, I'm not a person that likes to go to somebody and be like, I'm worried. You know, I don't generally flex that on people. I have a lot of self-dealing kind of things. And so that is a way of, I think, you know, you have that in your mind, and you work through it, you wake up, you're like, oh, but it's not true. You know, but then there's also, I actually have recurring dreams where I have places that are, you know, one is my mountain home that we grew up in Massachusetts, the cabin up there, that has a series of adventure dreams that come off from there. One is a kind of conglomerated work area, sort of an aggregate of different music buildings I've been in, and lots of these situations play out there. So it's almost like truly a dream theater. It's like I'm put in these places to either get that like primal, we're hunting and making shelters and getting away from packs of wolves or whatever, or we're scrambling around and is this the right room for this class to be in that I'm teaching? Oh wait, I'm in a class, I'm a student, you know, that type of thing sort of works out there. But very, all this getting to say that I rarely feel like my dreams are leading me towards somewhere, giving me a message for something. I feel like mine are very much, like you said at first, kind of in a way of me working out all the things that I see. And sometimes they'll have a very specific, you know, we'll be on a train and 2 nights later I'll have a dream that a train is going by, you know, in some aspect of it. So sometimes, you know, I'll remember where you're directly affected, or a certain situation will give you stress or joy or something like that, and it will work its way in the subconscious and back to the dream. So sometimes it's literally just a reenactment of good thoughts, or maybe not so great thoughts that you've had or experiences that way. Almost, you know, things that have embarrassed you in the past will sometimes creep up in the dreams. But no, I wish, I mean, I, you know, how great would that be to be the person that's like, the plane is crashing tomorrow at 1, you know, I have to call, I know this is happening. Or like you say, there are times where you do get a sense of change and that type of stuff. The idea that you could be getting messages, or that your body, even things that you're just not ready to admit, maybe it's your way of your mind telling you, or if you're ready for the change, it's your way of seeing that first before something may actually manifest for you. So, and Amelia, could you help with the dogs? Child. So yeah, Lulu is now, she's fixated on a squirrel or something.
Of course, it's fine. Yeah. I love it, it's good. No, that's a great answer. Yeah, I find dreams so incredibly fascinating. I get mad when I can't remember. I was like, I'm jealous that you can remember dreams so frequently, because I wish I could. When they escape me, I'm like, oh, I know it was something good. I wish I could remember what it was. So, all right. So let's move on to our second question. This one's going to be for you first. Here is the picture. It's a homemade sign, says love.
Yeah.
And the question says,
that feels very Yoko Ono right there.
Right. It's true. Might be. This question says, something specific you want for this generation.
Wow. Something specific. Gosh, I think it's a sense of empathy. Mm-hmm. I mean, I feel like this is the time where you should be able to put yourself in other people's shoes more than ever, because of the dissemination of information and of cultural iconography, written things, music. There's so much out there, but people still remain incredibly insular and not willing to go past what their first impression is of a lot of things. And for a generation that should have their fingertips at everything, I feel that people are surprisingly quick to rush to judgments and to be really didactic about their feelings early on. And I think the ability to still collect information, I think part of it is, well, not to say that there aren't people that are closed-minded and not willing to look outside the norm at any time in history, but I feel like we kind of, as early generation, you really had to search it out. Like, and they, you know, you really had to, you truly, you know, it sounds like walking up hills both ways, but you had to go to the library. Okay, what year, I heard this on the radio, it's like, what year did Tom Petty die? You're gonna have to wait, or like, what town is he from? You're gonna have to wait till you find somebody who knows where he's from. You can't just look it up, you know. Right. But there's a sense of adventure and wandering you kind of built up, and the desire to find new people and new cultures because you didn't have it where you were. And so I love traveling. As soon as I had a chance for exchange programs, and when I, you know, I'd meet people in other states, I'd really want to go visit and see that. And so some people are born with that desire to wander, meet people, get new cultures. But even if you're not, it's right at your fingertips now. You don't have to have the desire to go do that. So I think I hope that a sense of empathy comes from this generation, because that's pretty, solves a lot, right? I mean, it's the whole idea of, if you don't, you know, treat people like you'd want to be treated, and, you know, hope for that everybody can have the same kind of chances, and if they don't, understand that, you know, what you can do for that. So I think
That's great. I mean, I'm thinking something similar. My first thought was, I would love for this generation to truly be able to see, real equality across all cultures. Like, I mean, I feel like we're always walking toward it, and it's definitely something we all seem to want, but I feel like it's, you know, for various reasons over, you know, the past, at least my lifetime anyway, at least the last 40 some odd years, has always seemed like it's been such a struggle. And I'm like, why? Like, why do we have such a problem with equality? Like, it shouldn't be a problem. Like, we're all humans. We, at our base core, our DNA, we are all the same. So why is this inequality such a thing? And I would love for this generation to really see a time when that's no longer a question or an issue. Like, that's just not even, you know, we don't have to think about it anymore because it just is. And that would be amazing. I hope to see that in my lifetime.
Yeah, and I think there's no question that empathy is a large part of equality.
Right, exactly.
Not willing to look at somebody else and be like, well, why should I have anything better or worse than that person? You know, nobody is born more deserving than anybody else is. So yeah, no, I'm with you on that.
Yeah, no, I think that'd be great. That's genuinely my hope. All right, yeah, so
I just on that note, real quick. I mean, part of it, my siblings are both Korean, so my older brother and older sister are from South Korea. And were born in kind of deplorable type situations, you know, but certainly ended up in orphanages, sick and abused for a long period of time with a very, you see, there's not, a, you know, the way that their life started and then changed when they were 4 years old kind of thing. That just shows you, and I see them, they're 8, 10 years older, like I said, but I'm like, there's no reason that, you know, where you guys were born wasn't going to be the place that you ended up. Like, how terrible is that? That just from where you are, you may die of starvation when you're 2, or not, you know, inability to get medicine, which, you know, happens here too, obviously. But it's just one of those things that early on, I was just, I had no sense that any one people were more deserving for another. And a lot of it's just empathy. You know, you understand what other people have been through and what their situations are. So.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Totally agree. All right, so our last question here, this picture, it's a little hard to see. I'm trying to look at it through the camera there. Looks like there are people at a party kind of talking, socializing. Yeah. He's wearing kind of a fancy suit. This question says, a fashion trend that should never be brought back. I have some strong thoughts on this because the fashion trend that I really thought I'd never live to see again has actually come back, and it hurts me physically when I see it.
Uh-oh.
I have this like really strong reaction to it. It's the fanny pack. Like, I remember being.
I thought it was dead, right?
What is that? Right? I mean, I lived through it the first time, and my friends who had it, I was like, you people are crazy. Get rid of that terrible looking thing. Yeah. I will never ever carry one in my life. And then like last year, I walked into Target and there they are, like all over the place again in various colors and styles. And I'm like, what is happening right now? I thought we agreed this was a terrible idea the first time. Why is it back? I stand by this. I hope it goes away again and this time never resurfaces. It is my least favorite fashion trend of all. How about you?
Well, here's the thing. What I was going to say is that no matter what, they all end up coming back. You know what I mean? You mullets that they'd be gone, they came back. You know, mohawks have all come back. Bangs have come back. Pretty much, you know, I mean, like, what hasn't gone away and come back? There was, I mean, the neo-hippie revolution of the early 90s when the Gap was pumping out nothing but bell-bottoms and flower shirts again. Yeah. And satchels, you know, that came. So we're in, like, this 25, 30-year rotation. High-waisted jeans are now back in. Shorts where the pocket goes to your, like, what, V86 or whatever. You know, you're like, it's amazing. So there's a place for all of it. But, God, what do I want not to come back most? I think I would say still the exercise gear of the 1970s/early 80s. So especially small short shorts and leotards are probably the thing that should be out the most. I think those are the clips that get the most outrageous reaction from the watching those, you know, the videos. And they had one that was all of the all these super sports stars from 1978, you know, Pete Rose and all these guys in these incredible variety of briefs and undershirt combinations, you know, with patterns that you just, I think we're away from that. And I hope the leotards stay away. Yes.
Yeah, I think you might be right. Because now with the birth of athleisure, which is the next phase in that, those, you know, yoga pants you can now wear everywhere and your breathable shirt.
Oh, yeah.
So now it's
Leggings are just casual now. Yep.
Yeah. So now we kind of don't need the leotards to come back because we're sort of just living in some in between we've invented. So
we're just kind of yeah. Well, I think, and honestly, I mean, now who knows? It's like what everybody wondered about the judge for years. What are you wearing on the waist out? You know, we're not. I mean, the last time that I put on a suit, like,
yeah.
When was the last time we were in church? It's amazing. Yeah. So, but doing a lot more laundry though, sadly. It's funny how, but the fashion swing is pretty incredible, but now it just doesn't matter. So, but now it's masks. So have you seen that? I mean, they've got Vera Wang masks.
Oh, yeah. Buy.
They're bedazzled. And you know what? If you have a fanny pack, they can be easily transitioned to a mask, I'm sure.
So. That I could get down with. Don't wear it around your waist. I just can't. All right. Well, to recap our three great questions, we were talking about whether you think dreams are premonitions or just random, something specific you want for this generation, and a fashion trend that should never be brought back. Those are our three questions for today. Please email your answers or thoughts on these to me at msaavedra@chestnuthillprez.org. That's msaavedra at chestnuthillprez.org. Join the conversation. Thank you so much, Dan, for being with us today. We really appreciate you talking with us.
Oh my God, it's been a pleasure. My dogs have enjoyed it as well. So this has been great. This is great, Mary Angela. Thank you.
Thanks for watching, everybody. Have a great day.